Let's go. Goodbye rain, hello promise, I hope you're here to stay. Ain't nothing sweeter than welcoming new mercy every day. Hello sunshine, so glad you came, so glad you came. Goodbye yesterday. Your grass is greener than anywhere I've laid. You turn these troubled eyes to watching all my troubles wash away. Hello future, we're gonna be okay. We're gonna be okay. Gonna be okay.
Welcome parents, families, and friends, school and district staff, and especially fellow graduates. My name is Stephanie Diaz, one of the senior FCA leaders at CHS.
Pardon me, Stephanie. As Huddle advisor, I just have to interject and remind everyone about a few ground rules before we start tonight.
Like remaining in their seats so that they stay distance?
Yeah, but I mean, there's...
And wearing their masks, yeah.
Okay, but those are pretty common, you know, across the board.
And we can't forget about waiting to take photos with the graduates until we get exited from the Memorial Bowl after the service.
How do you even know about that one? Okay, but in all seriousness, we want to thank you for attending tonight.
Jesus says in Matthew, where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. We know how important relationships and community are to God. After all, our club is the Fellowship of Christian Athletes.
Despite all the additional logistics of having tonight's event in person, I do not exaggerate when I say it is truly special that you are here to prayerfully encourage our graduates, or in your guys' case, to reflect on your future and purpose and home in God.
Now, without further ado, we'd like to ask our FCA co-captain, Cabela Hendricks, up to open in prayer. If we could all bow our heads, please.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today with grateful hearts, thankful for the opportunity to gather here and encourage these graduates with your word. We pray a blessing over the message tonight, that the seed of your word may fall on fertile soil, that all attending may hear and understand, that your word may grow in these graduates to 100 times what is sown tonight. We thank you, God, for Todd Jones, our speaker. We are blessed to have him. We love you and praise you for all that you've done, Lord. Amen. And now for someone who has stepped up to the plate this year and been a true leader. They've risen to the challenge of leading with confidence and strength, working for countless unseen hours on plans, devotionals, graphics, etc., and directing our team with wisdom and grace. Ladies and gentlemen, FCA's captain, Luke Walker.
Give me just a second here. Here we go. It's a little windy this evening, as you can see. All right. Good evening, everyone. It is my honor to stand before you as a member of the Coalinga High Class of 2021 and as the Fellowship of Christian Athletes captain. 4 years ago, all of us here walked onto the Coalinga High campus bright-eyed and curious. Today, we take a pause from the hectic activities, the dress shopping, picking out a tie, dozens of Google Forms, payment plans, and we reflect. We reflect on these past 4 years, but more importantly, we look forward into the future. You make many memories in high school, from winning league titles and bringing home medals, and, you know, some of our best memories are simply being kids, grabbing a bite to eat with your friends, staying up too late, telling jokes with your buddies. And we often hear people refer to high school as the good old days. They look back with those rose-tinted glasses of nostalgia at the best times of their lives. However, a CHS tennis coach, Coach Walker, and for those of you who don't know, yes, he's my dad, told me, I hope high school won't be like that. I hope that for every single one of us here, we don't look back on high school saying that those were the golden years. I want us to be able to say, sure, high school was fun, but what I'm going to do is so much better. As said in Proverbs 19:21, many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. You see, the point of high school is to prepare us for the next stage in our lives. If we take what we've learned these past 4 years, not necessarily the Pythagorean theorem, but how to persist and conquer difficult situations, and pair that with a faith in Christ, the lives we lead will be fulfilling, successful, and so much better than anything we've done during high school. And like I said, 4 years ago, we walked onto the CHS campus bright-eyed and curious. We made new connections, strengthened old ones, and we got to find out more about ourselves as we prepared to head out on our own. There were challenges, and for me, and hopefully all of you guys, the good outweighed the bad. But we persevered, we pushed ourselves to reach our goals, and we succeeded. And in a mere 10 days, we graduate, hopefully just as bright-eyed and curious. Thank you. Now we've got Amanda.
Hello, everyone. My name is Amanda DeFosis, and we're going to be singing a song right now called Trust in You by Lauren Daigle. And in your guys' pamphlet, you can see the words. So if you want to sing along or maybe reflect upon them, that would be absolutely great.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I try to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I need you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So let all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I need you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust.
you, everyone.
Well, good evening, graduates. Does that sound good? Do you guys like the sound of that? No? Scares you? Well, I'm going to say it anyway. Good evening, graduates or future graduates in a couple weeks, or a couple days, 10 days, Luke said. Family and friends, my name's Jared Warren, and it's my honor and privilege to be the one to introduce to you our keynote speaker for tonight. For over a decade, he has devoted himself to raising up and empowering a generation of students to change the world. He's spoken at national youth worker conventions around the country, and he's the author of his new book, Jesus Colored Glasses. He's passionate, he's relevant, he believes every student matters. Here tonight, he's here to help you see your future, yourself, and your world a little more clearly. I present to you Todd Jones.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for having me. Sweet. That's exactly what I wanted to start with, is some feedback. So I'm glad that that happened. And if you see me hobbling around the stage, it is because yesterday I ran my very first half marathon. And yes, please, thank you. I was hoping that you guys would be as proud of that as I am. My daughter told me yesterday, she's like, "Dad, you're walking like Grandpa." I was like, "Thanks, kid. Appreciate it. That was really awesome that you said that about me." So you guys have done it. You're here. You're almost at graduation. You've made it through high school. You've made it through a lot of crazy stuff. I'm sure the stories that you could tell about the things that have happened over the last 4 years are wild. You've made it through that, and you're about ready to start a brand new chapter. You're about ready to head into a future where you're going, "I'm not quite sure what it's going to look like." Right, and maybe you're a little bit fearful of the unknown. The unknown can be scary. I remember when my wife and I went into our first ultrasound to see the first baby. Like, man, we're going to see this ultrasound. We're going to see this baby moving. And we got up there, and we're sitting there, and I'm super excited. And I look at the screen, and let's just be honest, nobody knows what the heck they're looking at, right? We, like, see this thing moving, and I'm like, it kind of looks like there's a cockroach in there. Like, I don't know if this is normal. And the screen kind of flashes, and I see the cockroach moving, and the scratches get, see some more. And the nurse asked my wife this question. She goes, "So have you been pretty sick?" Now, my wife had been super sick, like throwing up 9 to 12 times a day, right? You look at her wrong, she's throwing up. It was wild. And so she tells the nurse, "Yeah, I've been pretty sick." And the nurse said, "There's a reason for that. There's double the amount of hormones." And my wife understands right away what she's saying. She goes, there's two. And I'm like, "There's two? Two what?" Right? Like, what is happening here? And my wife's like, "Yeah," she's all excited. I'm like, there's two. I'm having twins. And it started sinking in, right? I'm a little slow. It took a while. And I'm like, okay, I'm having twins. So what do I do? I stood up and I'm like freaking out. I open the door to the hallway and I yell out, "I'm having twins!" Slam the door. And I started freaking out because everything started playing in my mind. I'm going to have two cars when they're 16. I'm going to have to pay for two college tuitions. Like, I started freaking out about the unknown. I'm like, I've never changed a diaper in my life, and there's about to be a lot of diapers. I started freaking out, and for maybe a lot of you, that's where you're at. You're like, "I don't know what the unknown. I don't know what the next few years look like." But you guys have an amazing future ahead of you. And what I've discovered is this, is that every new venture, every new thing usually turns into a new opportunity for insecurities. Like, wow, Todd, really really inspiring here, dude. You're going to hit me with, like, the good stuff. No, it's true. I remember when I went to college, it's like, man, I got this down. I'm awesome. I know what to do. And the first day I get there and I'm like, I think we covered, like, all of what you talked about the entire year of a class in high school, and you covered it on the first day in college. And I was freaking out. I'm like, I don't know what to do. I remember when I got married, I was like, I got this. And about 4.5 minutes into marriage, I'm like, this is crazy. I don't know what to do. I married someone who squeezes the toothpaste from the middle. Like, that's not okay. If you're one of those people, I just want you to know, it's not okay. Right? I figured I didn't know how to do marriage. I didn't know how to handle it. Insecurities just hit right away. Right, and maybe it's like you're like, I don't know how to do this job, or maybe it's I don't know how to even get a job. And there's so many insecurities that hit us in life, and then we get on social media, and it just makes it worse. Right? You ever started scrolling before and you felt good about yourself until you started scrolling? You're like, wow, cool, their boyfriend got them flowers. I wish mine would stop playing video games. You're like, wow, their face is really nice. There's too bad there's no filter that'll fix my face, right? Like, you start thinking these things about yourself and you feel worse about yourself the more that you scroll. Like, man, I'm just not good enough. And it seems as if the world is yelling that we're not enough. We're not enough. We're not good enough. We're not pretty enough. We're not smart enough. Right? We feel unworthy when we don't meet the standards that people have set, even the standards that we set for ourselves. Right? We set these standards for ourselves, and when we don't meet them, we feel like we're not good enough. I told you I ran this half marathon yesterday, and I was training for it, and I was getting ready, and about 6 weeks ago, my knee started hurting so bad that I was like, I can't run. I can't train for this half marathon, but I'm going to do it because I paid like $70 to register, so I'm still running it. I just can't train for it. And I started going, man, but I'm not going to get the time that I had wanted to get. I'm not going to reach the goal that I had set. Like, what's the point of doing it? I'm just not good enough. See, the standard that I set for myself, when I wasn't even able to reach that, I started feeling bad. I started seeing myself in a way that's not even true. Right now, you might be feeling a lot of things about the future. Going, man, I don't understand what I'm going to do. I don't know. I feel like I need to get all my stuff together and know either what job I'm going to get or what school I'm going to go to or all the things that are going through your head about the future. And maybe you're feeling that right now of going, I don't even know if I can meet the standard I'm setting for myself. All right, but what you need to know is that you are enough because your value is not in what you do. It's about who created and designed you. It's not in what you do. It's about who created you and who designed you. Our worth was the first thing that was attacked. Now, if you don't read the Bible, that's totally fine. I want to tell you what happened in the very beginning of the Bible. The very beginning, see, God made everything, and he's like, you know what? Here, I'm going to make everything that you see now. I'm going to make these trees. I'm going to make the dirt. I'm going to make the sky. I'm going to make all these things, and he did that. He did that in the beginning in chapter 1, and then chapter 2, he made people. And he's like, man, these are going to be awesome. He's like, these are very good. And then in chapter 3, we see that they're hanging out in this garden, this beautiful garden that God had made for them. And they're everything they have is wonderful. God has made it. God has designed it. And there's one rule in this garden. Don't eat from this one tree. There's one tree that they can't eat from. Everything else is go. You can go ahead and do whatever you want, but this one tree, don't do it. And as they're in this garden, this serpent comes up and starts to tempt Eve and starts to tell her these lies. Right, the first thing he said was, hey, why don't you eat from that tree? And she goes, ah, that's the one tree we're not supposed to eat from. And he goes, wait a second, though. Did God really say that? See, and that's what we hear a lot of times. We know what we should do. We know the truth. We know things that maybe you're like, I know I shouldn't do that. But then we start thinking, wait, but did God really say that? Right, he starts talking to her. And he starts convincing her to do stuff. And he says, listen, here's the thing. God said that because if you eat it, you're going to have the knowledge of good and evil. And you're going to know what to do. And you're going to be like God. And it's going to be amazing. He basically said the first lie right there that we ever see. He said, you're not enough how you are. You need something else in order to give you value, in order to give you worth. Much like the world we live in now, it's exactly the same. We're being told from every angle, you need something else to give you value. You need something else to give you worth. You are not enough. And so she goes and she's like, I don't know if I should do this. And she ended up doing this. And the incredibly sad part about the lie that was told to her, he said, you know what? If you eat this fruit, you're going to be like God. He told her something that she already had. It says in the Bible in Genesis 1:27 that God made mankind in his image. Right? She already had the image of God. She was already an image bearer of God. And she was being lied to and said, you need something that she already had. See, you're made in God's image. Every single one of you, you're made in God's image. You understand that there's nothing this world can promise you to give you worth, to give you value, because you already have it. The problem is this, though. The problem is that we believe the labels that we've been given. All right, we're all given labels, and we give ourselves labels all the time. All right, I ran this half marathon, and they gave me this shirt, and so I needed to get affirmation from all of you, and so I'm going to put this shirt on right now. Woo! Yeah, come on, there we go. My favorite person right here.
Okay.
So I got this shirt and I love wearing it, And my wife was like, you can't wear that too. I haven't taken it off since I got it yesterday when I ran. And I was like, I'm going to wear it tonight. She's like, no, you can't wear that tonight. I was like, no, I'm going to wear it tonight. So if anyone has my wife's number, if you can send her a picture, I'm like, I told you so. But I love this because it says that I ran, right? It's a label that I can wear right here. It says 13.1, and that's a lot of miles if you don't know. I ran them. They had this big old hill in the middle of it too. It was wild. But I love it because it's a label that I can show, hey, here's what I've done. Right, there's labels that are good like that, but sometimes the problem is those labels, those things that we've done, become who we are. And we hang on to those things. The other problem is that we've been given labels by other people in our life. Maybe you've had a person before that has told you something about yourself, has told you, man, you're just not very smart. Right? I had a guidance counselor in high school that told me that she didn't think I would amount to anything in life. I was like, lady, you're literally paid to tell me I'll do well in life. Like, that's your job. And she told me I wasn't going to go anywhere, right? But maybe you've been told before that you aren't smart enough, and you're struggling with stuff, and you've taken that and you've gone, you know what? I understand what you're saying. I'm dumb. And you've given yourself that label, or somebody's given it to you, right? Maybe when you look in the mirror, you think of all the things that you would change, and you're like, I hate this about myself, and I don't like this, and if I could just change this, and you've given yourself this label. Maybe somebody said it to you before, and you're like, no, you know what? I'm ugly. That's me. I'm just not good enough when it comes to that. And maybe things have happened in your life that have made you feel like, you know what, I'm worthless. Right? Maybe your friends that were friends at one point have stabbed you in the back, have left you, have treated you in a way where you're like, you know what, I'm just not good enough for them to hang out with. I'm really just super lame, right? That's me. That's who I am. Right? Maybe you've gotten different labels that you've put on yourself that people have given you, and you've said, you know what, you're unlovable. You're a failure. You're never going to amount to anything in life. Your life is just, it's hopeless. There you are. That's the label that you're going to carry around. Or maybe you're just not good enough at whatever it is. And you've gotten these labels and you're wearing these labels around. Right? And people are giving you the labels. But the problem is this, whether it's a family member that's given you a label, a teacher that's given you a label, a friend that's given you a label that you've given yourself and you've carried around, not just students, but parents. Maybe you've carried a label around for your entire life. And you've lived up to what other people have told you you needed to be. The problem is this, is that they do not have the right to label you. Nobody has the right to label you. See, because here's how it works. There's only two people that have the right to label something. The creator and the owner. Right? I grew up playing baseball. I played baseball all the way through high school, through college. I even played professional baseball. And when I was a kid, I got my first real leather baseball glove. Right? Before that, I was rocking the pleather. You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about? Some of you, when you played, you had that pleather glove. I got my first real leather glove. And when I got it, it had a label on it. It said Rawlings, because that's who made the glove. They were the ones who created it, and so they put their label on it. The second thing that was labeled on it was my name, because my dad was like, if you lose that glove, you're going to die. And I'm like, I'm too young to die. So I put my name on this glove, because I lost it, I wanted it to be returned to me. If somebody else came up and were trying to write their name on it, I'd be like, dude, you can't do that. You don't get a right to label this. Only the owner of this gets to label it, and the creator of this gets to label it. See, here's the thing, is that we've believed the labels that we've been given by so many different people, but they don't have a right to label you. Only your creator and your owner. And I want to tell you this, that God created you. And what he said about you is that you are very good, that you have worth, that you have value. And your owner is the person that purchased you. And what I believe, and I don't, if you don't believe it, that's okay. But I want to tell you, what I believe is that Jesus purchased you by dying on a cross for you. And when he did that, what he said was that you are worth it. You are worth me dying for. And in that instant, all the labels that you've been given, all the things that people have said about you, they don't have a right to say that. And you are not tied to that. Because the only person that has a right to label you is your creator and your owner. And we know what they've said. We believe the wrong labels. But what we need to believe is God's label. And he's saying this. He's saying, you are worthy. I'm going to take this off, even though I really want to wear it. But I'm going to take it off now. See, God's saying you're worthy. How many of you are shoppers? Love shopping? A few of you? Okay. You need to hang out with my wife. My wife loves shopping. Pandemic hit, and I'm like, awesome, we're going to take a break from shopping. No, a package shows up every single day, sometimes twice a day. You know what I'm talking about? Husband's up there, you're like, yep, you're nudging your wife right now. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Shows up. My wife, though, loves sales. She's never met a sale that she didn't love. And my wife will come up and she'll be like, I got this thing that's worth $500, but I got it for like 20 bucks. I'm like, hun, it's worth 20 bucks. It's worth 20 bucks. She's like, no, it's worth 500. I'm like, babe, how'd you get it for 20? Well, they were selling it for 20. I was like, because people are willing to pay 20 for it. Right? You know that. You've heard this rationale before, and it's true, because what the worth of something is determined by how much someone is willing to pay for it. We saw that when the PS5 came out, right? You're like, you know how much it costs in the store, but then you see the ridiculous amount of that people are selling it on Facebook Marketplace, because what somebody is willing to pay for it is how much it is worth. See, God was willing to pay the ultimate price for you. God sent Jesus to come and to die for you on the cross. And when he paid for you, he purchased you with his son's life. He paid the ultimate price. What he said in that is that you are worthy, that you have worth, and that you have value. See, I'm telling you right now, you guys look awesome. You guys got it all dressed up, looking great. You look like great people. I'd probably hang out with you, right? You're awesome. But I'm telling you right now, if it came between you and my kids, sorry about it. Picking my kids every single time. Every single time. But what God did is he saw us, he saw you, and he said, I'm willing to give up my son's life to prove your worth and your value. So even if you're not a Christian, if you're not religious, if you don't believe in this, what I want you to know tonight is this, what I want you to get is this, is you need to start believing what God says, not the lies that you hear daily. Because every day you're going to hear lies about your worth, lies about your value. But when we truly know what God says about us, that we're loved, that we're worthy, that we're valuable, it doesn't matter what the world says. See, I do something very strategic. I have four kids. I actually have four daughters. All right, so if you see any glitter on me, any sparkles or anything while I'm talking, that's just totally normal. That's my life. All right, glitter and sparkles are evil. You just can't get them out. That's a conversation for another day. I do something very strategic with my kids because I know the pressures that you live in, this world that you've been raised in, the voices that you hear, and especially the young ladies here, the pressures, the things that you've been told. And I know that as I raise my daughters, they're going to encounter people that are going to say things. And so I do something very strategic. I tell them every night when I put them to bed, I say, listen, Daddy loves you. Daddy thinks that you're valuable. Daddy thinks that you're beautiful. Daddy thinks that you're smart. And they hear it every single night. Every single night, over and over. And I do it because there's going to come a day. There's going to be a time where somebody at school, one of their friends, somebody is going to look at them and they're going to tell them a lie. They're going to tell them that they're ugly. They're going to tell them that they're not smart. They're going to tell them that they don't have value. They're going to tell them all the messages that we hear often. And my hope as a parent in that moment is that they will look back at whoever says that and they will say, no, I am loved, I am valuable, and I am beautiful because my dad says so. See, that's my hope for them. That's my hope for them. Yeah, you can cheer. That's awesome. But here's what I want you to know that's even better than that, is that your heavenly Father, God, that's what we call God, God the Father, has looked at you and has said that. And so when you encounter things in the world, when people want to tell you that you're not worth anything, that you don't have value, you can look back at them and say, listen, my dad has said something different and he was willing to pay for me with his son's life. Right? You have that power in you. Right? You have that because God has said that about you. See, when you find your worth in God, when you find your worth in what God has said about you, you don't have to search for it in other places. I'll end with this. I have a friend who's adopted three kids from Africa. They have three biological kids, and they've adopted three others from Africa. And I was at their house for dinner, and they just had tons of food, just this giant spread on the table. It was awesome. We had dinner, and as dinner was over, the kids took off and were playing, and we just kind of kicked back. And as I asked my friends, I said, so how has it been with your newest son that you've adopted? He's only been in their family for a couple months. And I said, how's it been? They said, oh, it's gone pretty smooth. Everything's great. But he's doing something that all the kids did at one point or another. After we put him to bed, he will go and we hear a noise. And we go out and we see that he's kind of snuck out of his bed. And he'll go back into the kitchen, into the trash. And he'll start pulling out scraps of food and digging through the trash. because he grew up in poverty. He grew up not knowing when his next meal was coming from or where it was coming from. He grew up understanding that he had to find all the scraps and the things, and so he would take them out of the trash and he would either hide them in his bedroom or go eat them there and try to keep this food. And as he was digging through the trash, I was just overtaken by the story, listening to it. I was like, man, I can't believe this is happening. And I said, what does that do for you guys as the parents? And the parents looked at me and said that I wish that he understood that this is going to happen every day, that every day there's a banquet waiting for him at the table. And see, my hope for each one of you is this, is that you would understand that there's a banquet waiting for you in Christ. When it comes to who he says you are, you don't have to dig in the trash for the scraps of the things that you think are going to give you value, of the things that you think are going to give you worth, of the things that you think are going to fulfill you. You don't have to listen to those voices. What you have to do is simply understand what Jesus sees when he sees you. See, we need to start seeing ourselves the way that Jesus sees us. Seniors, you've been given in your little pack there, you have a book in there that is pretty awesome. I wrote that book. It's called Jesus Colored Glasses. You can read it, or if you don't read it, you could try to sell it, but no one would buy it. You can pull these glasses out, though. There's a pair of glasses in here, and I want you to just put these glasses on with me for a second. Put these on. Okay, I want all of you to put these glasses on because these glasses are to serve as a reminder for you. The way that Jesus sees you is that you are valuable, is that you are loved, is that you are worthy. And when you look at yourself and when you look at others, this is to serve as a reminder that you have value, that the people in your life that are around you, they have value. They are worthy of respect and to be treated with the value that they deserve, not the label that they've been given or the label that you've given them, but that you should see them in the same way that Jesus sees you, that you have value, that you have worth. You guys can take those off, or you can keep wearing them because they're pretty stylish. But see, God says you're worthy, but he didn't just say it. He showed it. And my bigger prayer for all of you is that if you don't know what Jesus has done, if you haven't accepted the fact that Jesus died for you, that you would do that. I'm not going to make you do that or make it uncomfortable, but if you're at a point where you're going, hey, I want to do this at some point, talk to someone, surrender, because I know that we've all been in a place where we're grasping for what other people have said in order to fulfill us, when the only thing that truly can is understanding what Jesus has already said about us. I've been asked by your staff and faculty to close in prayer and to pray for you as seniors, and then I'll turn it over. But would you guys bow with me as I pray? Dear Lord, thank you so much for this group of seniors. Thank you for their sacrifice, for their hard work, for the things that they've done over the last 4 years to get to the place that they're at now. Thank you for these parents, God, that have endured many nights of unpleasantness to get to this point. I pray for this next step in their life. God, I pray that you would guide them, that you would help them, but more than anything, that you would help them understand their value in you. That in all the situations that they're in and that they're faced with, that they would remember that they have worth and that they have value. And if they remember that weird green glasses at some point, that they would know exactly what it means and that you love them and what you've said about them. God, we love you. We praise you. We pray this all in your name for these students. Amen.
Pastor Jared and I also have daughters. Maybe we can swap war stories later. And hey, Todd, horned toad. I mean, I think it's meant to be, you know, Todd, toad. But thank you. That was awesome having you up. And how far away do you live? 3 hours? So traveled 3 hours to be here today. So let's give Todd another round of applause. And graduates, before we conclude, there are just a few people that helped fill many roles and balloons as you came and you saw that made this night happen. So we just wanted to, first of all, thank Brandon Burrow and his staff for making sure everything was nice. They were out here mowing and nice green, right, to go with the book, green grass, very, very nice. And our sound tech today, Jehazel and Alan DeFosis and Jehazel Espiro. So thanks to our CHS staff and volunteers as you were coming through the gates and around the, as usher, Mr. Delano up here, Claire Sutherland, Megan McClure, Misty Carmona, Carissa Yeager, Jennifer Johnson, Stephanie LaPlante, Sarah and Millie. Thank you for the impressive balloon decor. And it was going to be front and center, but the wind was just extremely bad, but it's calmed down now, so it's subsided. And to Principal James Stotler, Superintendent Villanueva, Vice Principal Megan Inchcliffe, Debbie Bonilla, and Coach David Bonilla for the waters as you guys were hanging out in the gym. President Culbertson and all who supported and helped promote Baccalaureate this year. And of course, none of this would be possible without the partnership and help of Pastor Jared Warren and Chapel Grace with Misty Carmona helping out just a ton. And Jared, he was down here in the heat today. Why couldn't it have been like Saturday? You know, that was nice. But it was a nice nice of you to set up everything. And for all you've done this year, it's really been a help. Because I don't know what I'm doing. You know, I'm just coming in this year as advisor, and he's helped a lot. FCA has also had the support of donors throughout a hectic year, as well as guidance and support from our regional FCA representative, Marcus Martinez. We got to hang with him the other night at Night of Champions. And if you're wishing more of your family could view it, could be here tonight, we do actually have our video crew tonight filming it. So Jaime Perez, oh, he's already signaling. And Jesse Lucero, right here in the center. So media students, both finalists for the Slick Rock Festival, I might add. So awesome job, guys, and thank you for helping out tonight. And so that video link will be shared later this week. That just about covers it, except for we've got to recognize and give another hand and round of applause for our graduates here. Yes, graduates, let that sink in, like Pastor Jared was saying. And we're going to do the honor of letting them exit first as the exit song plays, called Faith by Jordan Feliz. So once that song plays, you guys can follow the track. If you want to sprint, you can. I mean, we're on the track. It kind of makes sense. No, you don't have to. You just walk out. And then, as we mentioned before, once seniors are out, then we'll have those in the stands be dismissed. And now, class of 2021, don't forget your gifts. Go and grab those. Go have faith. Thank you, guys.
There is no ocean that can't be parted. There is no mountain that can't be moved. I know there's help for the heavy hearted. The weak will find their strength renewed. You just gotta have faith. You just gotta have faith. It's life for the shadow. For all your tomorrows, it's knowing He's there through the sun and the rain. It's when you believe it before you can see it, and you can walk on, 'cause He's making a way. Just gotta have some. searching for purpose and know the waiting, praying through so many silent hours, finding a breath when you feel like fading, learning to love where you are right now. You just gotta have faith. It's light for the shadow.